श्रीमती रमन जानी Today's seminar is about water and its crisis. Something just which is very casual that allures more attention and significance whenever that becomes scarce or whenever the values are known or whenever there is misappropriation or exploitation and its ill consequences and wherever there is a conflict and struggle in sharing of the resources between people. So even normal things, they attain more attention, status, diversion, concern, research, scrutiny, treaties, etc. So water was a very just common entity in the world, just as a gift of nature or part of nature, which has attained a very great diversified levels of observation, scrutiny, and perennial concern about water and its sharing, distribution, harvesting, manufacturing, storing, applications in various forms. So everything, it has become a concern because of its misusage, misutility, or improper understanding and exploitations. So a very small thing that has gained a very great crisisial standard today, which we are going to discuss in multifaceted study and multidimensional solution approaches. And we used to start everything with the study of nature. And what is nature? Everybody knows about nature, and nature is a very fashionably coined word, and even the tradition speak about nature, and even the modern people, they have started speaking about nature and nature, go back to nature, bring nature, everything has started. What is nature and what is its inbuilt criterion? And what was the mistake that has been made by the people? Nature is defined as the structural precision and ethical management, that which is already there inbuilt with a stable phenomenon is known as structural precision. And whenever that structural precision is intruded, that is known as intervention, natural intervention. The intervention is of three types. One is invasive, semi-invasive and non-invasive. Taking water and drinking it, it is non-invasive, you are not going to distribute it. But whenever you are exploiting water more, now they are doing a lot of researches on over-exploitation of groundwater table, which has resulted in a very great holocaust in most of the areas of agriculture in Punjab, Haryana and Madhya Pradesh. So this becomes semi-invasive. Then atmospheric pollution and polluting water with chemicals and contributing to the climatic change, which has resulted in so many drought and unwanted evil consequences, which is affecting not only mankind but also the other livestock along with agricultural development. This is known as invasive. So nature has a structural precision and elasticity. It is having its own design. No doubt it is for our own use. Water, crops, forests, they are not just meant for seeing them and enjoying. Apart from scenic beauty, they have some utility. So it should be taken for your use. But there is some ethical base for this. So to take them in a level that it is useful for all, that is known as all-round benefit, long-term benefit, and renewable or regeneratable benefit. These three things are there in ethicism or moral governance of environmental resources. All-round benefit is coming for all people in all walks of life, and long-term benefit is using just thing out of our technical invasion, doing something here and then struggling for resources or for balances in the future. That is not of a long sight, that is a very limited, demarcated vision, which is naturally the blend of science, especially with most of the disciplines of modern science, which have no problems of dealing with the real solutions. So whatever they create, that's why I used to say in one science congress, one scientist also, he said the same. Science was first dealing about the problems of society. Now it is mostly concentrating on creating solutions for the problems created by science itself. So this is the stage of present science by which invasive, semi-invasive and non-invasive utilities, I've already told, it is not for just enjoying or worshipping or just applying in your eyes with a gentle touch or with a divine touch. You have to use it, but there is an ethicism of all-round, long-term and renewable and regeneratable modes of approach. In this manner, each and every element, there are three members of the world who are contributed to be the settlement in the nomenclature of nature. Number one is a human species, highly advanced, capable of understanding its own self, that is human being, they're having five major components in super specialized nature embedded inside. Awareness, second thing, what is structural and functional awareness. Number two, being aware that we are aware. Number three, clarity. Number four, the distribution of knowledge. Fifth thing is multi-componential understanding. You can know, you know that you can know. You can also make others kindle their consciousness and arouse them that they can also be made known. Number fourth, you can distribute this knowledge and communicate with other things. You can know about other things. So knowing about your knowledge, apart from knowing about your knowledge, knowing about other things also, knowing about the interconnectivity and capability for distribution of these four components of knowledge to everybody, this is a specialized natural network of human beings. All the other living beings, they are just having their own awareness for their limited functions and structural precision. They don't have elongated or extended consciousness and awareness by which they can communicate with others or contribute something or distribution. Everything is merely biological, whereas human beings having two journeys. One is a biological maturity, second is a psychological maturity or advancement. This is the greatness of human being. So the first component of nature is human. Second component of nature is subhuman species, starting from all the species, annelida, arthropoda, mollusca, apes, fishes, plant kingdom, everything is included in that, subhuman species. And third thing is the composite crust of the environment, which is there in the form of panchabhutas, which we used to call. We have to live, we have to have a clear substratum for our life. That is earth. Earth has three benefits. It can give you shelter. Number two, it can give you energy in two forms. It can give you energy in two forms. That is the greatness of earth. One is sadvaraka, second is advaraka. Direct and indirect. Directly it can give you all benefits in the form of timber, in the form of minerals, ores and various other wealth forms. It is directly being given. Regarding your physical nourishment, biological development, not environmental development, biological infrastructure development, it gives through plant kingdom. So earth has that type of mechanisms of offering you the shelter, offering you the shelter as well as the infrastructure, offering you ways for survival, establishment and prosperity by proper resources identification and management. So physical nourishment is given by the direct implantation within the plant kingdom, and indirect is given by the various resources which have been brought out by construction technology, chemical engineering, mining technology, infrastructure management technology and various other technologies. All things are external contributions, and internal combustion and internal development of the biological engineering is made through plants. So earth is the substratum for everybody, number one. And number two, everybody is driven by a force. Everybody is driven by a force. That force, we don't believe that water is the basic source for everything. According to Shastras, water has much energy than any other component of the world. Energy is there in three forms. One is in the solid form as the earth crust, as minerals. Whatever the minerals that are there composed inside the geocrust, the same type of minerals with same vigor and potence is configuratively hidden inside water also. The same thing is inside the air also. That's why hydral species, they are capable of living. And there were people who were toasted and roasted in penance and austerity who could survive just with water or even without water, just by respiration of air. The problem is adaptability. There is one composite adaptability system inside the human body. We are not so sophisticated enough to adapt or to be compatible enough to the water resources or to the aerial resources. So we have to take a solid food. So water has everything what we are having in the form of earth in the various other capable tabulations in the form of holes, minerals, salts, vitamins, this and that. All these nutritional, institutional, dietic, provocative, progressive mechanism tools that are there embedded inside the earth's crust in the form of soil. Everything is micronutriently incorporated into the air and water also. So the basic substratum, it is what we call in Sanskrit, dharaka, is the earth. Second thing, poshaka, whatever you may take inside, they cannot be directly taken into your system. It requires two pressure. One is a hydral dilutive pressure. Third thing is an aerial provocative pressure. Whatever you consume inside, unless there are some hydral species in the creation of God, whereby they don't require water. Most of the species, unless the coagulation of the food nutrition, it is taken inside, and that is being imbibed by various, for example, we are having saliva, we are having intestinal juice, we are having blood. These things are various vikritis of water. Water has prakriti and vikriti. Moisture, it is a prakriti. Rain, it is a prakriti. Stored water like ocean, pond, I think that is prakriti. And running water or flowing water, from the mountains in the form of streams and rivers. That is the prakriti. So flowing water, stagnant water, subtle water, uncondensed water particles that are condensed in the form of rain, everything is prakriti. And vikriti is the same water present in the form of salival juice, intestinal juice, tears in the form of juice in fruits, everything is in the form of vikriti. So water that substantially converts the primary nutritional matter, the primary energy which is in the form of solid, is diluted, potentialized, made compatible only by water. This is driven by an aerial force which is there in the form of oxygen to us, which is in the form of carbon dioxide to plants, which is in the form of nitrogen for fixation, which is in the form of methane for the abyssal species inside the oceans. So we are governed by three forces, in which the mediator is the water. We are governed by solid nutrition, which is diluted, driven and made compatible by a liquid force, which is pressurized by means of a pull or push of an aerial compression, by which this nutritional balance is traveling throughout the body, making a person to survive. Our survival between the aerial pressure and this contemporary system of contributive nutrition which we are studying in the form of solid foods, everything is put into balance only by water. So water is not only food, but it is also energy, it is also medicine. Water is having three things. One is ambrosia, second is panacea, third thing is a food. So it is nutritia, panacea and ambrosia. When it feeds you, it is nutritia. When it gives you knowledge, when it gives you comfort and elates you, and also elates your standard, enlightens you, that becomes ambrosia. And whenever that solves you all the diseases, all the predicaments of your bioimbalances, that becomes panacea. So understanding of nutritia of water has been made by people, but understanding of water as panacea and ambrosia has been made only by the scriptural study or the natural observation method. So substratum is earth, promoter is the water, the inducer is the air, and magma is what we call bhugarbha. It is inside the earth, it cooks everything, it processes everything. We have jatragni inside, each and everything is a thermal output. Kopagni, krodhagni, manthagni, kamagni, tapagni, ichagni, each and every impulse of our desire, depression, frustration, invocation, provocation, subjection, inquisitiveness, each and every depth and trend of our mind and intellect is a small, that is known as subtle hydral pressure, which is executed by a thermal induction. So in the science of psychochemistry, they consider everything to be thermal units. Everything is considered to be Agni. So Agni is a processor for everything. If air is an inducer, Agni is a processor, and the reservoir for replenishment and restoration is the ether. This is known as the Panchabhuta, the five primordial, or the penta primordial elemental study of nature of our ancestral tradition. So starting with that, coming to the contemporary studies, water has also its own zodiac. I have framed a hydral zodiac in one lecture on water. Water has 12 divisions, we have to understand. Number 1, drought. Number 2, it is flood. Number 3, irrigation. Number 4, it is drainage. Number 5, it is rain. Number 6, recycling. Number 7, water treatment. Number 8, as oceanography. Number 9, the issue of river linking, which is there now. And exobiosis, water possibility in other planets. That is the 10th issue. 11th issue is hydroelectricity power project with water. Number 12th is special utility of water in ceremonial, ritualistic and philosophical applications. This is a hydral zodiac which we have made. I think that it requires 3 days of seminar, 12 speakers speaking exclusively about these divisions. But still I will try to put it with the maximum possibility within the limited time frame. Number 1, first I have already told flood. There are 3 problems with water. Water crisis is somebody considering non-availability of water. Non-availability of water, number 1. Second thing, over-availability of water which cannot be tapped, irrigated or potted. Third thing, availability of water which is not drinkable because of pollution and some other contaminations. So, not availability of water, sufficient water. Availability of over-efficient water which cannot be tappable. Third thing is availability of water which is not drinkable because of its inherent contamination, which may be a peril to human life, inhabitation, or at least pernicious to his salubrity. So these 3 things we are going to take in this mega issue. Flood is very much we are famous. Everywhere we are reading about Bihar flood. Every year there is no newspaper or there is no such incident which is devoid of a flood report from Bihar. So how to manage this flood? Unfortunately, I want to say that Indian Engineering Department or the Engineering Infrastructure Management has not been improved or has not technically improved or not funded also to deal with this type of thing. That is a special type of engineering to control flood. It is known as active river dynamic engineering. The name itself is very much alienistic and Hellenistic and Greek and Latin to most of the engineers. It is active river dynamic engineering, which is very specially to be designed for flood. What is the location? What is the total area connected? And what is the river basin depth? What is the capability of water retention and storage? What is the flow velocity? What is the water that can be retained? What is the danger limit? And what is the limit of observation that we are having possibilities for discharge? It is known as active river dynamic engineering survey. Apart from which, there are few methods in understanding these things. One is erosion problem. Second is inundation problem. The third thing is landslide problem is there. Third thing is bridge embankment problem. Fourth thing is sedimentation problem. Fifth thing is river shifting problem. Sixth thing is waterways for road and railways. That is also an issue now in growing infrastructure. How to deal with all of these things, we have to say. Number one, in the problem of erosion, we have to measure the area eroded and the water flow velocity, etc. In inundation, we have to measure the water flow, the density of water, overflow, and the drainage possibilities for the water, and impact on infrastructure damage, impact on live losses, as well as loss of livestock, etc. How we can govern all of these things. And each and everything has its own steps of understanding. Now they have been making lot of things like there is a possibility of constructing spurs. For erosion, we can make spurs, we can make guidance bunks, we can make revetors or revital devices, and we can make embankment devices, we can make tolerant devices, we can make gradual suppressors, we can make underlying storages and deviators we can make. And also for flood management, there are three possibilities. One is afforestation ground possibility. Second thing is deviation of the same thing to the local bellets. And third thing is gradual depreciation or gradual reconsideration of the water velocity by iron bunks, which are known as interim bunks, which are there in the gradual flow shift or flow velocity of the floods. And actually, Mississippi, due to Katrina, you know that it has been heavily flooded. And Bihar, due to the Kasi River, how much it is flooded, it is known. But the active river dynamic engineering that is specially there, which requires a lot of things. One is evacuation of people and properties. Second thing is to create a zonal differentiations by which it is a danger zone, and it is a risk zone, it is a crisis zone and safer zone. You have to make zonal platform and analysis, and we must know about the aboriginal of the inhabitation and aboriginal of the flood. Flood affecting a particular people or inhabitation area is different from the aboriginal area. So starting from the aboriginal area itself, there are three possibilities. That is why very great experts, they used to say, India is well versed in flood control, not in flood management. So starting from the aboriginal area, three possibilities. First possibility is, can it be tapped and converted into energy resources? Number two, can it be diverted to some other area where the loss can be prevented or minimized? Number three, even if it enters, how to train the people in self-management and mitigation of probable losses and risks at the time of flood? How to make flood management as a course which should be given for the NGOs, self-training and group training exercises? These things are very much essential. And comparing to that of the developed nations, we are very much behind. For example, China, it is having 2,77,000 of river dikes with 8,500 reservoirs and 7 super specialized river flood management special devices up there. So flood engineering systems have been installed in 7 major power blocks of river dynamics with 8,500 reservoirs and 2,77,000 of river dikes. This is not there with us. We have already designed few things which I want to say. The Central Board for Irrigation and Power, along with the National Hydro Power Project, both of the people, they have proposed before a decade a good proposal for Brahmaputra and tapping of Brahmaputra resources for getting 40,000 megawatt of electricity possible. So that reduces the pain and strain of flood management, as well as the risk of loss of lives, shifting, evacuation and inconveniences, as well as producing good, well-tanned, refined, clean, zero wastage, powerful resources to the country for increasing the power wealth of our nation. But that has been put into total dustbin and it has not been considered at all. Only particular project has been sanctioned before 8 years, which is also there in still hold, which requires more augmentation and more participation. It is not there. And even in the system of, there are innumerable systems, no doubt we have developed after that independence. In the 60 years, we have made 4,000 dams. And we are capable of making billions of units, more than 220 billion units of storage capabilities, that's a water. So 220 BCM is there for India, and compared to that of the previous pre-independent era, construction of 4,000 dams and having 220 MCB is very easy. And it is very thing laudable also in one point of view. But when comparing to that of Egypt, Egypt is very small. Egypt is very small in population, population distribution, need, emergence, and in provincial status also. But still they are having 120. For them they are having 120 means we should have at least 6 times more, that is 720. Comparing to that of two nations, one, China is having equal populace, equal consensus, and equal development, equally democratic, adjacent Asian competitor, they are having 600. So the million cubic productivity for this China, that is the BCM level, that is 600. Whereas for the smallest country in other comparable standard, it is 120. So this 220 for India is something very, very uncompromisable. So now for 2020, I know that 2020, it has no practical dawn or light. As that word 2020 sounds to be very melodious and rhythmic, everybody is pointing for 2020. It is not based on a person's confidence level. It is not based on a clear way of assessment of a person's productivity ratio. It is not based on calculative, arithmetic, progressive study, logistic study, statistic, or statistical studies. It is just based on a rhythm. Everybody was saying about 2000 before 30 years. You may be knowing 2000. At the year of 2000, we'll be having agricultural development, bank reforms, economic reforms, computer to all, everything they were quoting 2000 because it is a round figure, 2000. Like that, February 2, 2002, everybody was saying that the miracle is going to happen. Nothing happened except getting SMS from all people that it is 2002. Like that, 2020, they are planning for 200 more billion cubic units of storage capability. So our billion capability is going to be improved from 220 to 420 as expected in 2020. So this is something which they are connecting with these people. What we can do in flood management is we have to get a special institute, like we are having institute for hydrology, hydropower resources, hydro statistics, hydrodynamics, oceanography, like that we used to have a special design, either getting a training from most advanced countries like UK, US, etc., where Thames has been well governed, Mississippi is under control as well as management, there we have to get a specialized training. Also, there is a possibility if some Indians, out of their own inherent Indianized knowledge, if they sit and work out with normal civil engineering and infrastructure management skills, totally having a commitment for 5 years, they can do wonders, they can bring pride to India without having a technology transfer guidance or training from other countries. It should be made up. The second thing is drought, that is other extreme end. If this is this extreme end, that is the other extreme end. It is total uncontrollability. It is total non-availability or insufficient availability. For that, there are some measures. Gradually, now with the development of the Indian Meteorological Department, they are having some sort of prediction or prognostication or climate weather forecasting methods are there by which they can say that the monsoons, whether they have come or not, or they are going to come or not, they are going to shift or not, what is the angle of diversion or postponement or mitigation or collision, what we call aerial collision, in which the monsoon collides without coming here. So there are 10 possibilities. It can collide, it can align, it can divert, it can be mitigated, it can be maximized, it can be turbulently charged, or it can be totally nullified, it can be postponed, it can be advanced. These possibilities are there. The problem with the meteorological department is they cannot select a single possibility from these 10. They will say that all possibilities are possible and we have to experience and say which is true after the thing happens. That is the problem with the Indian Meteorological Department. Now they are given a lot of reports. Now the problem with the drought is about three reasons. One is the natural water retention capability of earth has been degraded. There are three regional problems. One is an absolute problem or an universal problem. Second is a zonal or specific problem. Third is an interconnective problem, which is based on usage and other resources. So one is artificial based on usage, exploitation, etc. Second is the land structure, the groundwater table, and other structural systematic levels that exist in the particular area. Third is universal components like climate change, like monsoon change, or rainwater non-harvesting, or over exploitation. These things are very much concerned with the whole globe. So it may be a universal problem, it may be a specific problem, it may be application problem of the particular people located in the country. So for example, before 2 or 3 years, they have given a report. For 2006, they have given a report of 286 MMC, they have given the report. For which, actually they have to get this 292 for three things. Water is meant for potability, second is for agricultural irrigation, third is for extra domestic and industrial usage, and fourth is for some other development utilities like hydropower, electricity and other things. So water has innumerable usage levels. So whatever they have predicted for 292 has come only to 286 with a deviation of 1 minus 1. And this meteorological classification, there are divisions and subdivisions for meteorological classifications. For India, there are 36 divisions of meteorological classifications, out of which 10 subdivisions, they have reported deficit. And 26 other people, they have reported accession or normality. So meteorological predictions, they are having three things. No standard, stable, reliable predictions are being made, number one. Mere predictions cannot come for help without proper drought management, number two. Number three, simultaneously you cannot govern both the beneficial and maleficial works. Simultaneously doing drought management by rainwater harvesting and other things, simultaneously exploiting. When we are having, you see, pressure is different from compression. We were having gentle pressures by means of the wells that we have been using that has gradual natural oozing of water, which is inbuilt in the poral system of the earth itself. Second thing, we were having hand pumps. Now the compression, the engines that we are using by means of this hyper compression, even the storage water, you might have heard of a story wherein by the golden egg giving duck, the belly will be cut off by a person thinking that he can get more eggs. How it will be possible? The ground table water or the third level of water, the first level of water is for plant nourishment. Second level of water is for human contribution. Third level is just like the radiator inside an engine, which is meant for earthly functions and further water multiplication. It is known as hydro multiplication, or it is the hyper elasticity principle of nature, by which it reserves something not for itself, for giving you more. Even if by your hyper compression methods, if you get more water thinking that you are getting absolute fertility, the future possibility of hyper multiplication of water sources and distributions will be totally drained and made dry, so that you will get into drought. So these type of artificial manipulations and mismanagements of water, contributing along with the pollution, climatic change and the global warming alerts, we are suffering into drought. We need a total plan, and the change will take at least 30 years because the problem has occurred and it has started before 200 years. Industrialization area, whenever we have started the industrial revolution, that started also the revolution of the environmental pollution. So it is a revolutionary for environmental degradation also. We have contributed 44,000 million tons of carbon by industrial development to the natural earth, mother earth, to the ether, to the great ozone, by which the natural bounteous shower of the earth has been prevented, instead of which we are getting, if you just get into the breast of a cow and just charge the nipples, you will get milk. So instead of getting a gentle milk by just caressing the nipple, if you are countercharging the same cow with a knife, you will get only blood, not milk. So now we are getting what? The blood of nature. We are not getting the milk of nature. That is the problem. And there must be a global renaissance. There must be a global awareness. Like this, all universities, all rural people, we are all people with coat, suit and tie. There are a lot of rural people without shirts who are doing the mistakes and victimized by the mistakes. So victims and victimized by the mistakes are there abundant in number in rural and tribal areas, deep in ignorance, subservience and untold miseries. They have to be taught, and renaissance should be brought from that period onwards. And our duty is to prepare a module and a systematic syllabus as well as a team for imparting this knowledge to all of these people. That is a drought. So apart from which, I want to also say about one type of drought in which, apart from human beings, other livestock, they are affected. It has been made into a very great scrutinizing research by two people. One person is known as Dr. Engel, and second person is Dr. Redfern. These two people, they have made a research on graze management. Graze management and introduced forage, which is not developing in India now. It is known as graze management. How to make these other subhuman species to survive in drought. So we have to learn three things. One is drought survival. Second is drought management. Third thing is drought control, treatment, or getting the natural bounty by methods. pipeline project, storage devices, moisture harvesting societies, rain harvesting societies. These things are for other development sources at the time of drought. Second thing is drought control is minimal use of water, proper use of feed. These things are for just management things. Survival is drought resistant species are there. Naturally, drought resistant species are there. Number two, now by transgenic plants, those who can control temperature and maintain drought resistant system inside have been newly developed in transgenic biotechnical species. We are having that. And even after 10 years, I don't know whether there may be a special injection or any genal implantation or mutation can happen in human life. Due to which they may say that the human being, a transgenic human, at least he should drink one water per month or one water per year. It is more than enough. He is also drought resistant, transgenic. It may happen in future. So these things are the various drought management system. In grace management, it is a very different science. There are five major components told by these people. Like Red Fund, they have given five major things. One is to totally avoid prescribed burning, which they are doing now, dahana in farms. And number two, total reduction of fertilizers, total reduction of herbicides. Number four, rotational stocking rate instead of cyclic or standard stocking rates. Number fifth, to have a wholesome consideration and care for winter feeding process, without which production of more hay at the time of drought cannot be made possible. These things are purely scientific, connected with the ranging or the grazing management which is given to the other livestock at the time of drought. Then coming to rain. Rain is a divine blessing. Everybody is saying, somebody asked me, if you say rain is coming by our rituals or worships, then why rain is coming in Chirapunji, why rain is coming in Albania, Tanzania, Uruguay, Zimbabwe, who is doing rituals there? Then I told that whatever you do, good thing, that is a ritual, number one. Number two, whatever you do here, it is not only going to rain for you, it is going to rain for everybody. It is Vishwa Kalyana, it is for universal benefit. So ritual need not be a very systemic and organized physical or peripheral ritual. Number two, benefit need not be very much provincially captivated and limited towards your end. So rituals are happening, and ritual is the root cause for benefit for wholesome world. That's what I told on that day. Apart from which, we want to say about some rain. One is phenomenal rain. We know that water evaporates and the same water condensed into water drops come back as rain. It is phenomenal. Second is prescriptive rain is there, invoked rain is there, provoked rain is there, indicative rain is there. What is prescriptive rain? Each and everybody's moral responsibility to the nature that brings rain. Honesty, purity, distribution, service, disciplinism, this thing they protect rain. So this is second. Provoked rain is whenever we are doing, that's why I told in one seminar, there is no rain at all. We don't get the real rain. We get rain whenever we are having cyclones, typhoons, monsoons and seasonal impairment. We are not getting regular real rain. Rain has become a byproduct. Instead of being a direct feed, it is now residing as a byproduct for seasonal errors, misbehaviors and celestial accidents. So whenever there is a celestial accident, whenever there is a misbehavior, whenever there is your erroneous consequence, then only you are getting rain. So whatever you are getting in the form of rain is a punishment, not nourishment. So that is the second thing. So prescriptive raining is by our characters. Provoked rain is through, there are two provokings. One is provoking by these accidents. Third thing is provoking by artificial rain and other things. Invoked rain is by prayers, I've already told. Indicative rain is there. A real person who knows the rainology or the Vrishti Shastra, he can clearly say what the rain indicates. It may be Kshama, Amaya, Kshaya, Arajaka, Kalaha, Yuddha, Parikrama, Divya, Anugraha. It may indicate the arrival of a person, departure of a person, anarchy inside a country, monarchy inside a country, democracy inside a country, freedom inside a country, chaining inside a country, liberation of a person or liberation of a kingdom. It may also denote internal conflicts, external wars, arrival of new diseases. Somebody asks, what is the creativity of human beings? He has created lot of new disease-causing species, and he has improved pandemics and new diseases and disease causing enzymes. This is the creativity of human beings. Due to lack of stagnation, drainage mismanagement, habitual mismanagement and environmental mismanagement, we have created two things. New species, dengue and this chikungunya. We may be knowing about chicken, not chikungunya. Now everything is new diseases. Whenever you eradicate a disease in the pandemics, a new disease is coming. Whenever you invent a new medicine, it is created with antibiotic resistance. Oh, you are creating a medicine, I will create my own resistance. It is also competing with us without any lab research work or without any PhDs. It is being done by this pandemic society, pathogens, they are doing that. So this is the creativity of our things. So it may also create amaya. indication. So indication of rain that creates drought, famine, conflict, war, anarchy, monarchy, various things I have told. This is the indicative study. Certainly I believe that one day we have to organize a seminar which may be interesting, mind-boggling, and there may be a lot of oppositions for that, and we have to face the challenges and answer them very comfortably. That is also there. So this rain has not been artificially made successful. It has been artificially made. Before 50 years it came into account, and now we are also having China recently tested and brought rain at Beijing. Dubai they have tested twice, and Mexico it has been doing for several months. But what is the problem? It will totally spoil the climate pattern, the environmental wealth, the water resources and soil. Now recently you know that China had a good record of bird flu, in which all birds and human beings, they competitively died with each other. Everything is caused by only this thing. So using all of these vehement toxins like calcium chloride, calcium oxide, then dry ice, silver iodide, these things are very great chemicals or toxins which create a system of bombardment, a system of agitation and coagulation, which makes the water vapor to be absorbed into the micronutrient shell of this chemical catalyst, which is then condensed into the form of water. So it is very dangerous, and it is inviting death, either a gradual death or total annihilation in disguise. So real rain should be brought by good behavior with nature, good behavior with fellow human beings, good behavior with gratitude and magnitude towards God and His creation, loving nature, transferring mutuality, fraternity and interrelativity with co-inhabitants of the society, demarcated in the forms of caste, clan, religion, provision and language. These behaviors only can produce real rain, and science is going to believe that this is the only possible way after few decades. Then coming into irrigation, farm irrigation, institutional strengthening, and now recently there is a possible way in which the joint participation method or the participation method of irrigation has been recently produced. Recently they have created a joint participant irrigation method which is conglomerated with technologies, new irrigation technologies, sprinkle irrigation, drip irrigation. The more we have become parsimonious with water, water also become very much parsimonious to us. Water has also become parsimonious. So there is a competitive parsimony between both of the people. So technological developments for water storage, water movement and infrastructure, water storage management and reservoir management is there. Then socio-institutional methods for removing the conflicts that is there for water sharing and other things. It may create conflicts in the society. There are a lot of water policy issues and water legal related issues are there. This is a socio-institutional method which we want to say. Then third thing is environmental. By applying environmental technologies, we can totally deal with good biodiversity. We can deal with the issues of water degradation and soil degradation. Economically, technology is going to help you for increasing land value as well as productivity of the land. So in modernization of irrigation, that is the irrigation technology, the first thing is environmental for degradation challenges, economical for increasing the productivity and land value. The third thing is socio-institutional, which is for conflict resolution, to create compositive and collective farming, as well as to resolve the policies and legal issues that are coming in land and irrigations. Technology is very much used. Apart from which, technical storage devices, like there are innumerable technical storage devices for irrigation. Chinese devices, about 300 devices are there. Storer, sprinkler, joint sprinkler, sensor sprinkler, innumerable devices are there which are connected with time analysis. They know about the time to sprinkle, quantity to sprinkle, different quantities required to sprinkle, seasonal sensation, which season, how to sprinkle, climatic reflection. There are four sensors. One is a climatic sensor, second is a seasonal sensor, third is a crop identification sensor, fourth is the quantity sensor, fifth is the time management sensor. Apart from that, to make it intermittent, to make it perennial, to make it with intervals, to make it rotary and disciplinary, everything is there in irrigation, modern technologies. This is irrigation. The final problem is drainage. Wherever there is drainage, you see there is a problem. It is very difficult to deal with drainage. There is urban drainage problem which we are seeing at the time of rain. At the time of rain only we have to see. The real beauty of a place is to be seen at the time of its rain. Real beauty is evinced only at the time of rain. So most of the cities, they reveal their Miss Universe are Mr. Universe status only at the time of the rain. We can see how it is mismanaged, how there is drainage managed. Industrial drainage is there, agro drainage is there, urban drainage is there, innumerable deficiencies that are causing stagnation of water, lot of inconveniences, warehouse and storehouse for innumerable diseases, everything is happening by that. There are three possibilities told by people which nobody is going to do. One is reconstitution, a reconfiguration of the whole planning system itself. Already they have been planned in such an atmosphere where this awareness was not there, where this expansion was not there. Totally evacuate these people and create new storage diverters, alternative diverters, alternative slide devices in either ends of the roads can be made, and alternative under storages and recycling methods can be also utilized. So restructuralization, revamping and reconfiguration of both the construction model as well as the drainage management engineering, it should be made, which is not easily possible. Now the problem is coming, I've already told, the third problem with water is we are getting water which is not usable or which is dangerous. For that, water cycling, recycling and treatment is there. Now we are having adverse osmosynthesis by means of reverse osmosis method. It is known as adverse osmosynthesis. Whatever that is happening, you are reciprocating it. So it is known as reverse osmosis, and for advanced problems they are saying that advanced reverse osmosis, that means that it is advanced danger. Now recently there is a research institute publication which says that drinking mineral water is dangerous to health. It may create ontological problems. What is ontological problem? Ontology of body is resistance. If resistance is not there, then HIV AIDS may happen, or even oncological problems like cancer it may occur. So it may create that problem. The problem is whenever you recycle the water, not only the unwanted things are removed, but the wanted homeostatic devices which are implanted as microfilters inside the water, they are also totally removed, by which the natural resistance of human body is eroded. Already human body is weak, genetically, inheritedly, inoperatively weak, and moreover the circumstances also polluted. This water is also incontributive, so get into diseases. Recently a survey report of Holland University Department of Pandemics, they say that mineral water is dangerous. So science invents new things, then asks us to stop. Use computers, stop computers. Use mobile phones, stop mobile phones. So each and every decade, it starts with inhibition, and the same decade ends with prohibition. This is the modern scientific tune in which we are all struggling now. So water recycling, we are having reverse osmosis process, then advanced double refined filter process, nano filtration membranes are there. Third thing is point of use exclamators are there. Finally, we are having some sort of ultraviolet utility for disinfection, and ozonic treatment for disinfection is there. But a natural, there are two things. One, improving your power of resistance even though the water is defective. Third thing, make also the water effective. So simultaneously, the person's receptivity, adaptability, compatibility and resistance along with the effective usage of water, both should be given concentration, which is not given at all. So what I am saying is, this type of osmotic process, this type of advanced process, they are not only giving a disease-free water, but also they are giving power-free and energy-free water, which is not going to support you at the time of imbalances. Second thing is, we are having settling process in water treatment. Water is having a lot of problems like bacteria, like fungi, like algae, iron, sulfur, arsenic. Recently, I went to Bihar for a project on water treatment for specially arsenic-affected water and diseases. How to treat the patients, drinkers as well as the drinkable water. I made a project report and we have selected a village also. There, how to treat, how to make a treatment plan, and how to make a composite tablet by taking which the arsenic can be diluted and excreted without causing any harm to the body. We have made a project like that. It should be very specific. It is a very webinar, but exclusively I want that it should be project specific, problem specific, province specific, person specific, technicality specific, tactics specific, trouble specific, and team specific and time specific. Without which we cannot bring it. It is just a common view, a global and universal view. We should have something specific. So we are having settlement issues, and we are also having coagulators. We are having aerated biodiseases are there, and also advanced sludge control devices are there for this treatment of water and recycling. We are having innumerable things, but still abiding by nature and increasing one's own stuff are the most advisable things which have been given by our people. Then coming to river water link, which is a very big challenge. Lot of people have done, even before 100 years, there was Dr. Arthur Cotton, before 100 years, who designed first the river linking project. He told that there is a possibility of river linking for South Indian rivers for agriculture. Second thing is Dr. Dinsha J. Doste. he has created a very good program which was named as Garland Canal. It is known as Malagathi or Garland Canal, in which all the rivers can be brought as a garland, irrigating all places, avoiding floods, drought and famines. And recently, Dr. K.L. Rao, he has prepared a very fantastic report for the Ganges-Cauvery link. His situation is like that. He has drafted that from Patna, coming into Sono, then Narmada, Tapi, then Godavari, Krishna, Pennar and Kaveri. That was the route made by this person. And it is very difficult. It is known as techno-economical viability. Whatever we can draft in papers, we can say that connect Kaveri and Ganga. We can connect two ladies known as Kaveri and Ganga by making them sit together nearby. But connecting a river that inquires lot of things about economical viability, technical possibility and other sensational issues. More than sensible issues, sensational issues are there. People will shout, parties will shout, states will co-state, international implications will come. Even in this Ganges project, getting into 2,840 kilometers of travelling energy of 450 meters depth of water of 60,000 cuseks to be brought inside your area is not so easy, economically viable. And there is already a treaty between this Bangladesh as well as India in the Ganges river water. There is a Ganges treaty between Bangladesh and India, and there will be international implications and oppositions from Ganges because that thing will be disturbed. It will mislead the treaty and dilute the value of the treaty. So that is a problem, and it is not also possible. Now, resulting in that, there are three possibilities given by the research people. Number one, to consider the Ganges as well as Brahmaputra not to be brought into west or south, but which can be extracted to the immediate west by making it flow to the southern areas of UP Haryana. Immediate possibility, not thinking where is Brahmaputra, where is Kaveri, where you can, we are going to link that. So immediately proximate areas where there is a need is the western direction, that is the southern area of UP, Haryana, etc., where you can divert, possibility number one. And number two, there are peninsular and Himalayan components of rivers. They can be easily adjusted with. Instead of these Ganges and Kaveri, Mahanadi, then Godavari, Krishna, Pennar, Kaveri, this link is possible. But who is going to negotiate with the Orissa CM and how he is going to give that? Even a proximate area of Kerala, they are quarreling for Mullai Periyar and Karnataka for Kaveri and Krishna for Andhra Pradesh. Even the proximate co-participants are quarreling. How these non-participants at the distance they are going to coagulate with each other? It is very difficult. That is the problem with these people. Second thing is there are some rivers which are belonging to the Himalayan components, which are known as the rivers like Kalind River, Parvati River and Chambal River. They can be united. There is a possibility. And there is one more possibility of uniting this Netravati, Barda and Badavati. These things they can be united because they are very much connected to each other. The other option is this Bay of Bengal connection can be, link can be made for the rivers which are having connectivity with submersion into Arabian Sea. There is a possibility of this diversion by which the rivers can be made more productive because they are proximate. Apart from the political bias and political non-cooperation, economically, technically, they are proximate and possible. There are three problems. Nobody is accepting, even in spite of flood, no state government has ever accepted in drafting that they have excess water to give to others. Write it in a golden plate and read it twice. In spite of, I will be destroyed by my own water, but I am not able to share it for others. This is the motto of the people. Nobody has given it in writing, they are saying, but nobody has ever given a statistical report that they are having excess. Number two, normally there is opposition for this eastern deviation of the western flowing rivers. Third thing is political bias, which I have already told. These are all the problems which are with these things. Then coming to exobiases, is there water in other planets? Is there a possibility of water formation in other planets? Is there any possibility to get an APL, aerial pipe link to bring water from Mars? That is also going on somewhere else. Simultaneously, researchers are going on for exobiases. The science is known as exobiology, and the phenomenon is known as exobiases. And hydroelectrical power project is only if there is water and there is flow and direction and potential, you can get hydropower project. We started the hydropower project at Darjeeling in the year 1897. Now comparing to the first 10 years, the recent report, 8,000 megawatts, the capacity has been increased. But 9,000 million units, the productivity has been reduced. So capacity is going on, it is inversely proportional. Capacity to produce more is going on increasing and the produced capacity is going on decreasing. Because of water stillation, because of preference to irrigation more, there are other innumerable political and other issues. Farmers are sensible as well as sensational. Irrigation is also something sensational. Most of the people are like that. So you can opt only two things. There are three problems of comeback of earth I already told. One is earth is struggled for crops, food. Second is for fuel, biofuels. Third is for medicines. Like that, water is also having come back for three things: to produce crops for our usage and also for getting electricity. So there is a triad or a trilateral compared for this earth producing water also for three different issues. We have to give preference only to our sustenance. Then only see if machines are going to flourish and man is going to decline. Who is going to use the machines and who is going to be benefited? So man first, mind second, machine third is our philosophy, in which we are going to end in a disastrous calamity if we are not going to realize this thing. Coming to the conclusive session, one thing, what is the physical structure of water? Everything, you know that you are composed of water. That is why you are having that at the time of eclipse, full moon day, new moon day, you are having eruption in your hydral standard, you are having eruption in your secular standards. That is why that lunar influence creates you to be a non-lunatic or lunatic. That is also designed by that. It is a physiological, that is one interesting shastra. It is known as Ashruvidya. On seeing a person crying and seeing a person's tears, we can clearly say that whether it is intentional, unintentional or something spontaneous. Third thing, whether it is induced or produced. Induced is by smoke and garlic onion. Produced is by smoke and other things, etc. And they are applying this glycerin and other things. They are known as produced. And induced is by smoke, etc. Even in that, there is a shastra known as Ashruvidya. And we are having also mind and water. By taking water, mind is specified. If a person, that's why I want to say, I told in one yoga seminar, the first food of human beings is air. He has to take full respiration. In one food security lecture I told, you have to take full respiration in the form of pranayama. You must have a casual breath, deep breath for you, by which you take more air. That is the first food. Second thing is water. That is the second food. Nobody is taking water. Either they are taking over water, over consumption of water at special occasions, unused or unruly occasions, or totally they are not taking water at all. They are taking like the Agastya, or they are not taking water at all. So mismanagement of water. Second food is water. Third food is your solid food. Every time they are munching and masticating like grinder and mixing machine. So if you take more air inside, more you will be potentialized. So take more air. Second is take more water. Automatically you will have more energy consuming less food. Maybe the real energy of food can be captivated inside you, capitalized inside you by consumption of more air and water, by which proper food distribution and food security can be made. More productivity of food only is known to the science, without understanding how to eat food and how to manage the food within the sources. That is not taught to the people at all. So water is our food. We must consume water, and more than that we have to consume air. This is one mystic message I want to say. Then water, apart from being our food, I have already told that it is a medicine for our diseases. It is also utilized as a mind pacifier, intellectual boost. Whenever you take pure water, then leave quietly for 2 minutes, you will come into tranquility. More you can listen, more you can attend, more you can observe, more you can return. Water is a good memory booster, natural memory booster. So intellectual boosting, mind pacification, physical nourishment, everything is in water. We know that we use water in ceremonial and rituals. If you do like this, it is prokshana. If you do like this, it is sparsha. If you sip and drink, it is achamana. If you just lay like this, it is known as marjana. If you just rub like this, that is punarmarjana or sammarjana. And samprokshana is the same thing done with the specialized mantras and applications. Drinking is pana. Taking bath is snana. Submission to God is known as agya. Submission to ancestors is known as tarpana. See, giving the same thing for some assuration or some assurance or ascertainty is known as dana, vara, varana. So in dana, vara, varana, samarpana, tarpana, pujana, havana, kalasa, sthapana, prokshana, punaprokshana, sammarjana, marana, samprokshana, innumerable ceremonial and spiritual rites are governed by water. Water is a good carrier. Water is a good container of divinity. Water is a good carrier of positivity. Water is a good charger with divine bliss and potence. So we have to preserve water. We have to do three things. We can take our choice. Love nature, worship nature, or properly behave with nature. If you know about this divinity, worship it. So if you don't consider it is to be worshipable, don't do pujas and spending your time. You don't like, yes, come for loving the nature. I don't know specially how to love nature. So at least behave properly with nature, because the shastra say that nature is having a responsive mechanism for your magnanimity, purity and mercy. If you are magnanimous, the earth gives more, air gives more, fruits gives more, it gives more flowers, it buds more, it ripens more.
it reproduces more. So nature, apart from fertilizers, apart from irrigation, apart from soil fertility, nature is more productive, more responsive to your characters, how you behave within yourself, with everybody and everybody around that. So it is known as exo behavior, intra behavior and internal behavior between all systems. So I believe that in this water day, we take a resolution, a strong determination to develop love towards nature, to develop good behavioral understanding and execution towards the nature, and try to worship nature by understanding our valuable traditions, so that not only water, that's what I want to say, nature has five components, they are interrelated. If you spoil one component, every other component will be totally put into turmoil. If you develop one component, everything else will be interconnectively developed. So we cannot expect a single benefit from nature, considering water as a separate thing. You cannot attribute or contribute for water development. You cannot do something for water degradation mitigations. If you want to develop water, water will develop only with all other natural components. If water is going to perish, it will perish with all components. So if you are spoiling water, water spoils every component of nature, digging your own grave. If you are properly using water that nourishes, that very much controls and indicates and revitalizes all other components of the nature by which a holistic development is made. So this day has been the day of awareness for us to understand water, to nourish water, save water, use water and to worship water. We pray that more water resources to be there. We have to pray for three things. We have to do that prayer now, either in mind or after reaching your home safely. You can do that without my disturbance or involvement. Number one, pray for more water. Number two, pray for proper utility of water. Third thing, pray for the remedies for our past mistakes over the two centuries. So we have to do prayachitta. What is prayachitta? Remedy for whatever we have done for the two centuries. Number two, samriddhi. We want to get more water. Third thing, vinyoga distribution. Let us pray for more resources. Let us pray for more distribution. Let us pray for the divine pattern by which once again we are given the second choice of a fruitful survival in the world. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.